Okay, if I can wrestle your attention back away from your conversations. Nope, we need 30 more seconds for this table. I hope you had an opportunity to get to know some of the folks that are here today. I'm just curious, maybe sort of as a gift to Bishop Selders, any issues that came up at your table that you're kind of hoping he's going to talk about, because you opened it up and now you're hoping he's going to maybe get to talk about it? Anything at the tables you just want to, you know, a quick bullet point? This was an issue that we thought was really important, or we were really going to learn more about that?
Just we live separately in Connecticut. It's self-evident, but it's a white community that we are in, and there are black communities in other parts of the state, and we generally, I'm speaking for myself, don't interact with each other. So how can we get a better understanding of what the other people are going through?
And vice versa.
And vice versa.
Thanks, Ben. Other topics, questions that came up that you want to put a bug in John's ear to sort of be thinking about that? Supreme? Well,
piggybacking off of that, you know, because we live apart, because there's little opportunities for conversation, you know, concrete things about what can we do, you know, beyond, you know, where do we go to show up? How do we do this? Where when we do live apart and there are a few opportunities to get to the other side.
Great point. I know for some, when we were beginning to raise children, that question came up, how do we give our children life experiences that are not just with other kids who are the same color as our children? And really wrestling, how do you do that? Those are they don't happen automatically. That something intentional has to happen for that to occur. Other questions quickly before we bring John up? Yes, Randy.
Like everybody here, I care deeply about this issue, but sometimes I wonder, what can we really do that's going to make a difference? You know, where does talk give way to some type of action that really makes a difference? You know, for so long, it's been a conversation about this, that, and whatever. I've been listening to it for 50 years, all right? And it's the same themes, all right? Repeating themselves today that I heard back in the late 60s. So, you know, what do we do to really make a difference? Break through this ring of frustration and validate our fellow citizens.
Thanks, Randy. Some of what you're saying is the reason that we reached outside of our community to bring someone in to speak with us who has a whole different range of experiences and has been talking about this for many years with lots of different groups. So we're looking, John, for some expertise that comes from outside of our community, because we don't always have good direction about what are some things that we can do to make a positive difference. So we're going to ask Sue Roman, who recommended that we invite Bishop Selders join us tonight to do an introduction of John, and then we'll hand the baton off and look forward, John, to hearing from you.
I thought Rick had given such a nice introduction that I was not going to get a chance, but I'm glad I did. I first heard Bishop Selders speak at a forum in Hartford last May talking about racial profiling among the police, and there was a very kind of intense conversation, and he spoke of being pulled over in Wethersfield, and the look on the police officer's face when, you know, he thought he was pulling over one thing and then he saw the clerical collar, and, you know, he had his chuckling, but it was like, you know, come on. You know, that somebody has to go through that is, you know, why we're here. I mean, it's just ridiculous. And I've also been following, though I have not had a chance to participate yet, in he's leading up the Moral Monday movement in Connecticut. And that's a movement that started in North Carolina, I guess about 2 years ago. North Carolina had a change in the state legislature, and that state legislature pushed through a number of laws that were going counter to voting rights. and really doing a lot to cut people out of enfranchisement. And a number of people, including Reverend Barber, started showing up on Mondays at the courthouse, and they got arrested, and came back next week, and another group came with them, and another group the next week, and another group the next week, and it was a great sign of persistence and the fact that you can't go away, you have to continue to be heard. And the Moral Monday movement in Connecticut, last Monday they were on the commuter route going out of Hartford on the Bloomfield Avenue to get some, open people's eyes. And I guess this time it was Pamela's turn to get arrested. Last time Bishop Selders was arrested. It's willing to put themselves out there to get the message out. I think this is not as risky a form here, but I was very pleased to have him. He is not only a minister who has taught at the Yale Divinity School and is part of Trinity College. He's also an award-winning musician and pianist, and has also worked in the past on HIV/AIDS rights and awareness, and a number of other causes that need a strong voice. So very pleased to call him up here to give us a bit of his strong voice. Bishop Selders.
Wow, that was cool. Thank you very much for your introduction. And thank you for the invitation, Rick and the entire team, ministry and staff and everybody, or what they would say where I'm from, everybody. I will slip into African-American speak, just a disclaimer. I'm also a black preacher, so you have to talk back to me. All right. I just need you. Those are two things I'm clear about. Our time together will be an interactive time. I'm trying to get a little timer on so I can be on time. I have a tendency to talk too much. I've been gifted with the gift of gab. We're going to start there, and then how about that? Okay. Rick is going to be my clicker. What I want to spend time, I want to locate and talk about location for the next bit of my time at least. And tell you where I'm from, a little bit about where I've been. Then I want to talk about where we are. And then I want to talk about where we got to go. All right. I'm from St. Louis. Yeah, I'm gonna hate you in a minute. I bleed Cardinal Red. I just need to tell you that last night I was having a lip poked out because they lost my red bird just a little bit, but that's all right. And I'm real testy about it too, so sorry. I'm gonna wriggle.
We're gonna put it safe.
Thank you, because there you go. Sorry, recorder. Didn't mean it. I'm going to say a little bit more about this picture in particular and why I chose it, but we'll keep going. You know Ferguson, but I bet you didn't know anything about a Ferguson until a year and a few months ago. I know Ferguson because it is the town next door to where I grew up. Kinloch, Missouri. Kinloch is just due west of Ferguson. In fact, Kinloch, it used to be named Kinloch Park. Kinloch is the first and oldest African-American incorporated town in the state of Missouri. I was born, they tell me, at Jewish Hospital Tuesday afternoon. And when the week or so after, remember back in the day, it wasn't just a few days and they kicked you to the curb. Your mamas and babies stayed at the hospital for a week or so and some extra. They tell me I went from Jewish Hospital to the corner of McHenry and Hugo, 5601, to my grandmother's home. These two people right here are my paternal grandparents. The bishop, that's the dude. And mother, the boss. The preacher and the musician that I am today are because of these two individuals. My grandmother was the pianister, as that's what they called her. She was the piano player, and my grandfather was the bishop. I didn't know my grandfather. This picture was taken a year before he died. He died, had a heart attack in 1948, recovered, and then subsequently had an additional heart attack and the next year, 1949. I didn't know him in body, but I've gotten to know him over the years in spirit. And I am because of them. Can you go back one? Can you go back just one for me, please? These are notable daughters and sons of Kinlock. Jennifer Lewis, you may know her as an actress and just general overall cut up. I know her because she used to call me Big Head Boy. Tell me, how you doing, Big Head Boy? And she's hit me. Well, you can't tell now because I got a lot of hair. But I got a hook back here. You know, you can catch it real good during you. That's, she was a jokester. The person you see on TV is the person I know in person, live and in color. The person you've seen in the movies, I know her real well. Also, Congresswoman Maxine Waters, her home is Kinlock. And those, some of you who are over a certain age will remember, wouldn't you like to ride in my beautiful balloon? Wouldn't you like to ride? And you had that look right there, and you had dashiki on, and then you had the thing going, the tie-dye, and circle rides. If, yeah, I see you over this age. Yeah, you're okay. Yeah. Billy, Ron, and Lamont were all from Kinlock. All three of the men of the original Fifth Dimension are from my town. From my town. Kinlock is very important to me. Now you can click on, keep going, go past granddaddy and grandma. Now I'm gonna talk about why I picked the picture of the arch and that courthouse. Go on back, go back, go back, Rick, go back. Keep going, go all the way back, all the way back. One more, right there. That courthouse was where the Dred Scott decision was rendered. How many of you know what the Dred Scott decision was? Oh, so some of you do, some of you don't. The Dred Scott decision, now you can keep going, going down the line, going down the line, right there, created what we now know as law. I use this picture. The red states, they still are red, were the slaves holding states. Green states were the free states and their territories. And then you got some brown states, they wasn't on the blip screen. That was Native American land, largely. The Missouri Compromise, 1821, allowed for Missouri to come in to the Union in 1824 as a slave state, while wonderful Maine came in as a free state. Keep going. This dude here cracks me up. Chief Justice Roger Taney, and he said in his majority opinion, he said this, we think that people of African ancestry, didn't use that term, but we'll say that, are not included and were not intended to be included under the word citizen in the Constitution and can therefore claim none of the rights and privileges which that instrument provides for and secures to citizens of the United States. Being of an inferior order and altogether unfit to associate with the white race, either in social or political relations, and so far inferior that they had no rights which the white man was bound to respect. How many of you knew he said that? Yeah, now them hands go down further. So you wonder what happened in Ferguson a year ago. You wonder what happened. I know what happened. Pamela knows what happened. She's from St. Louis. My children were born in St. Louis. My life got changed August 9th, 2014. Something happened that thing happened and something changed in me. So all of my remarks tonight are couched in this social location. You with me? I can't talk about race now without talking about Ferguson. Because what happened in Ferguson has something directly to do with me. Pamela and I, when we got on the ground, first of all, when it happened, my mother called, my mother-in-law called. Pamela has brother and sister that live in Ferguson. We got family, I got nieces and nephews. One of my nephews is the best friend of the mayor. The mayor that said we don't have a race problem. Y'all remember him? And Goober and Barney Fife and those boys down there, them good old boys, excuse me for being it, I'm not being facetious, that's just the way they are. They, you know, why would you turn tanks on citizens? Tear gas on, and the rant that says they were hooligans and thugs, these were children. They were my nieces and nephews. They were my babies. I know them. I know them. When we got on the ground, I'm looking at folk who I know their parents before they got to be their parents. Mm-hmm. These are children. My grandma was 18 years old. You know some 18-year-olds? You know, have you been around some 18-year-olds recently? You know how much mouth they got on them? Right? Don't quite understand, and I'll say more about that later. Keep going. I'm framing my conversation with two frames. This is my spirit guy. His name is Howard Thurman. Howard Thurman was a mentor of Martin King. In fact, he was a classmate of Martin King Sr. He said, "Don't ask what the world needs." My language, dumb question. Ask what makes you come alive and do that. Because what the world needs, people who will, can, must, do, come alive. Keep going. And this guy right here. If there is no struggle, there is no progress. Those who profess to favor freedom and yet deprecate agitation are men, are human, are people who want crops without plowing up the ground. They want rain without thunder and lightning. They want ocean without the awful roar of its many waters. This struggle may be a moral one, or it may be a physical one, or it may be both moral and physical, but it must be a struggle. For you see, power concedes nothing without a demand. It never did, and it never will. Strong words, strong language, keep going. This is my guy right here. The Reverend Dr. Cornel West says, "Never forget that justice is what love looks like in public." Keep going. August last year, group of clergy, you'll be well advised that the two dudes on the right side of the Episcopal priest, one is the dean of the cathedral in St. Louis, Christ Church Cathedral. The other guy serves another parish in Ferguson. My little brother there, the black guy with dreadlocks, his name is the Reverend Osaji Fuseku. And festivities happen, I'll call them festivities. Happened on August 9th last year. I got a text that was from him. His text read, "Bruh, dude, the crib is on fire, ... Ferguson." The crib, African-American speak, for the house, at home. I text back, "What you talking about?" He said, "You watching TV?" "No, I just finished watching Melissa Harris Perry. I'm good." He said, turn the TV on. When I turned on CNN, I see now streets you know well, West Florissant, Canfield Street. Scenes and settings and places and spaces of my youth, all in turmoil. You know something about that here in Newtown, don't you? We can connect there. My town, my hometown, was on fire. And so, after a while, I couldn't stay in Connecticut, could I? And so, last October, we were with the delegation that risked arrest. And I stayed in that position, face to face. I'm fourth down there in the middle somewhere, you see me. For 3.5 hours, face to face. I'm over 50, I got to go to the bathroom every hour. No bathroom going, was it for me that day? We were out there total over 4.5 hours in a torrential rain. It was one of the holiest acts I've ever been a part of. Part of the action was to say to the police officers, you're part of a racist system. And I understand that. I'm a person of faith. I'm here to call for you to repent. And I'm here to receive your confession. Now, I'm a Protestant, I'm not Catholic. And so that's a little hard, that whole confession thing was a little difficult for some of us Protestants. But we were Christian and Muslim. We were Jewish, Baha'i. We were Unitarian Universalists, no particular tradition at all, but of faith. Asking for people's, for cops to come off the line. They were, one point, one officer gave one of the sisters a hug and broke down in tears. It went from that on a dime to this. Because they had drawn some kind of line. I don't know. We were in a parking lot, for God's sake. At the police station, public building, I thought. And yet they had drawn a line that we weren't to cross. And when we went to cross it, hell broke loose. 40 some odd people were arrested that day of faith for standing, kneeling, singing, and praying. Where are we? Where are we? So you just saw a bit of where I come from and what I've been through the last year or so. Where are we? This is a picture depicting, we think hangings happened down south. How much you want to bet that they happened here in Connecticut? Let's keep going. Anybody know this dude, this guy? Theophilus Eaton. He was the first governor of the colony here in Connecticut. He said this in 1638. He was a slave owner, and he announced that he had been holding blacks in slavery for some time and would continue that practice forever or during his pleasure. This was reported. He said it over and over again enough that this was reported by his daughter in a book she wrote of her memoirs and memories of her dad. I'll tell you one other interesting thing. Brother Eaton's grandson is Elihu Yale. Know that name, Yale? We know that name, Yale. Because his grandson is the namesake of Yale College at that time, now Yale University. First generation New Englanders promoted racism and slavery and passed the earliest law sanctioning slavery in this country. In 1641, the Massachusetts Bay Puritans enacted
their code of fundamentals or the body of liberties. In Article 95, in part, it says, there shall never be any bond slavery or captive among us unless it be lawful captives taken in just wars or such strangers as willingly selling themselves or are sold to us. Interesting clause, isn't it? This code became formal law 20 years before Virginia's or Maryland's laws. Keep going, Rick. Most recently, there's been protests over the last few years about Calhoun College, right? How many of you know that there's actions afoot to do something to deal with the fact that we have a number of slaveholding colleges that are part of Yale University. Now, what's interesting about this particular artifact that was, by the way, purchased by an alumna of Yale. See the part here that's missing, the clouds? What used to be there is a slave, a black person, shackled together, kneeling before Brother Calhoun. This painting, this stained window, was in the building that was formerly the residence hall of the Divinity School. Keep going. This is Connecticut stats. Statistics, I won't bore you. I get deep off into these statistics and stuff. My wife tells me it's too much. She helps me. I won't bore you with them. But I'll have you look at several things and have you to notice some things. I heard the question about our segregated communities. Mm-hmm. Population of Connecticut is about a little over 3.5 million, right? Just take a look and see what sticks out at you. I can tell you what sticks out at me. The median income is about $70,000 a year, just shy of $70,000 a year for a household in Connecticut. 48% of the folk in poverty make less than $24,000 a year for a family of four. Household is considered a family of four. Tell me something ain't right with that, or something's wrong. And the question that I would have you explore is why? Thank you for asking that. I'm gonna try to get at it a little bit. All the stats I'm gonna throw at you. All you really need to notice is the one that got the most people in it, black people. Do black people commit more crimes than white people?
No.
We know statistically that we all crime, as far as ethnicity is concerned, is about the same. About the same number of people, criminals in your neighborhood that they are in mine. That's what the statistics say. Yet black people are by and large, and brown people, you put both black and brown people together, woo-wee! That's a lot of people arrested over white people. Is there some reason? That's your question. Keep going. Dr. King said that by the basis of disparities between the races had as much to do with economic injustice or inequality as out-and-out, outright racism. Many white Americans of goodwill have never connected bigotry with economic exploitation. They have deplored prejudice, but tolerated or ignored economic and justice. He said the inseparable twin of racial injustice is economic injustice. Hang on for a second. I'm going to stay right there. The question gets asked over and over and over again. Here in Connecticut, we are the richest state per capita in the United States. We all know that. Do we argue that anymore? Is that can we make that assumption? We're pretty wealthy here in Connecticut. Then why are we the host of the poorest cities in the country? Hartford is the second poorest city in the nation. Brownsville, Texas is the first, according to Mary Wright Edelman's group, the Children Defense Fund. Hartford, Bridgeport, New Haven. Let's throw Waterbury in there for good sport. And New London. Some of the poorest cities. When 160 years ago, Hartford was the jewel city of the Industrial Revolution. So much so was it the capital of commerce and the just on and popping, that's what we say, on and pop, that Mark Twain decided he would live there next to Harriet Beecher Stowe, and they would create a whole, because of course, you couldn't publish a book and be successful unless you were around the book publishers, that Hartford was the leading book publisher of this. See, so within the period of 150 years, we go from the city to the city. When speculation and wealth, people who do insurance, they're not poor. The industry is not poor. That's an amen moment right there. Yeah, the industry is not poor. Yet, it leaves behind a poor city. Love this man. Love this dude. This dude just is off the chain. He said, I prayed for 20 years. Got no answer until I start praying with my legs.
Amen.
Keep going. So let me throw out at you the last few minutes I have left, and then I'm going to be in a little bit of dialogue with you. Dr. King, his letter from Birmingham jail, laid out for me what has been Bible for me. And before I read the Gospels, I've been reading Martin King. So if you haven't read Martin's letter from a Birmingham jail recently, can I recommend it to you as some reading? Sure. But I declare, when you start wrapping your head around it, you're right, brother. 50, 60 years ago, here we are. But I think he laid out something for us that has become for me where I'm at right now. He said to these folks, now he was responding to a group of ministers who had asked him to slow your roll, to wait, I know it, stuff is bad, but you know, over time, you know, here's some good, well-meaning men of faith. And he said to them, listen, in any direct action, first off, I'm not an outside agitator, and I'm irritated that you would call me an outside agitator. Well, let me just say, I don't always talk back to my detractors, but I felt it was time now to address detractors. You know, I'm too busy doing the work, but I was asked to be here. But of course, then here's another one of his famous quotes, injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. I'm just over in Atlanta. Here we are in Birmingham, and this place is off the chain, and they just come from the campaign in Albany, where the police was real nice to them. So we didn't have, you know, Bull Connor wasn't so nice. So what we had was the drama that was played out on television. Now remember, this is the early 60s. By 1960, 50 million households had TVs. We had just come out of the 1950s, where it was the time for everybody to assimilate. Suburbs became the rage. Everybody had a car or two, garage, driveway, suburban life, the cul-de-sacs. Remember when they were Vogue? No, Better yet, leave it to Beaver. Warden June, Cleaver and the Beef, Wiley, Eddie Haskell. I remember, as I was thinking about this recently, I remember I didn't see a black person nowhere. Didn't know Lucy had red hair. Just want to sit with that for a minute. We came out of an era of unprecedented growth economically. But what was steaming down south that most folk didn't hear about unless you were in one of these churches up north, around some rather liberal folk. 1955, the Montgomery boycott took place that whole year for well over 384 days. Can you imagine doing anything for 3 days straight? That meant you had to be inconvenienced? Can somebody be for real here? You're not going to get in your car and go to where you got to go. You got to find transport, you know, just to be inconvenienced. We stood out on the line for 15 minutes, and I mean the hate mail we've received because we gummed up the traffic for a few minutes. I want to, and I'm laying this on pretty thick, because I want to suggest a couple of things. Dr. King, in this letter, laid out what you do when you do a direct action. He said, first of all, you got to investigate to see if there's some injustice done. Secondly, then you gotta get into some negotiation. You gotta talk on it for a little bit. Then he said, thirdly, you know, one must do some self-purification. You gotta get ready. And then finally, he said, you gotta go out on the line. It's time to do some action. Mm-hmm. I've remixed his words just a little bit to suggest that if we are to be involved in changing the damn world, because that's what the task is, right? That's what the task is. The task is to change the world. Okay, I'm gonna say it again. The task is to change the world. The task is to change the world.
Amen.
Faith without works is what?
Dead.
What makes you think our generation gets off the hook? We don't get to a pass because we are too old, or we've been doing it for so long, or somehow or another we don't have black people in our community. That ticks me off when I hear that term. Because that really is, I know what you mean, and I'm not talking to anybody here necessarily. But what I am saying is, it means, what you really mean is, since we don't have black people here, we don't really know what to do. We don't really have anybody to push us or challenge us. And I'm going to say to you something that I say often in these spaces and places. If you mean to do right, you'll find a way to do it. In fact, if you intend for your child to get what you want them to have, you get it to them, even if they don't want it. Now with me, you're going to hear from me when you trash the stuff I gave you. But at the end of the day, it was what I wanted you to have. And then at the end of the day, you do whatever it is you want to do with it. But if we intend right, if we, even in our well-meaningness, if you mess up and make a mistake, if you make a mess, make sure you take a broom and dust mop, dustpan, sweep and start over. Isn't that what we do when we make a mess? There's a boo-boo, there's a spill. We clean it up and keep it. We don't say, oh my God, I'm never going to have another drink of nothing like that ever again because I spilled the last cup. We laugh. But some folk in race matters, because you had a not so good experience with one or two black people back off 40 years ago, you stopped doing anything. This mic on? Some of you know what I mean. Yeah. And that's not right. If you, I'm gonna keep going. Let me keep going. Now, go back. Let me remix. You got to call a thing a thing. Dr. King said investigation. I'm calling it what Ayanna Van Zandt said. She said, just call a thing a thing. When you mess, just something, you look at the statistics around our urban centers here in Connecticut, they just are bad. The schools are bad. Unemployment is bad. Drugs are bad. Pookie and Ray Ray ain't got no access to nothing. What you expect them to do? Let me tell you something about dope dealers that I know firsthand. Most dope dealers I know don't really like the game because they know it's short-lived. Most dope dealers I know want to take care of their baby mamas, want to put some Pampers and some food on the table, and want to take care of their mother. That's most dope dealers I know. I know a couple. That's what they want. Not too many of them want to do what they're doing, but they're forced into this underground economy because they ain't got nowhere to go to work. So then I hear over and over again in Hartford, we've got 30, 35 murders this year, and it's all the rave. Every year we got more murders and, you know, up and down with the murder rate. Bridgeport, New Haven, same thing. And then I hear over and over again from the politicians and the powers that be, oh, we need to do something, but you only hear that once the murders start happening. And finally, I went on the air, I was somewhere publicly speaking, and I said, you know, hadn't this been happening over and over again for the last, say, 35 years? When are we going to get ahead of the curve instead of following? And then, please, did the last time we had an uptick in hiring and more police, did that help solve the problem? Did that fix the violence in our community? Because in September, when the state troopers went back to their own regular, Pookie and Ray Ray went indoors until the next season. Every transition season from winter to spring, there's an uptick in violence. I said, rather than hiring more cops, give me 6,000 jobs at a living wage. I bet you we'd stem some of the tide. We may not fix it all, but I bet you I'd stem some of the violent tide because Pookie and Ray Ray go to work and they won't have time to gangbang as much. That's just, but I wonder, it's not rocket science to me, but maybe I am asking for something too much. I don't know. Okay, we keep. Let me go back one more time. I'm sorry, Rick. I'm sorry. If I had the thing clicking myself, I'd make myself do it. Tell the truth. Secondly, get into some strategic conversations. And don't, and for God's sake, get into conversations when you're not talking to the choir. Remember them conversations where it's all you and your friends and y'all slapping hands and y'all, and get into the conversation where people disagree with you and struggle for real. Okay, and so I'm not talking about talking. You know the one that you can't never get along with and you're never going to get along with and it's going to turn into a yelling, screaming match? I ain't talking about that. Well, I do have my favorites I listen to for about 5 minutes per week. I find AM radio station. I do listen to that dude for about 5 minutes. That's all I can do. But I check in. I watch 8 minutes of that other TV station. I do. I watch it because I want to hear what, you know, commercials included. 8 minutes and then I know I'm going to hear something kind of, I'm on the other side of the aisle. I know where I am. I know, and there are people here who may be on the other side of the aisle in your lives. I got some. My nephew said that the mayor of Ferguson was a great guy. Yeah, I don't doubt that he's a great guy. He was wrong. His two left shoes to say there's no racism in Ferguson. Ha! And now we got the Department of Justice and their report that documents it pretty clearly. Strategic conversation. Then thirdly, Dr. King said self-purification. What they did in the Civil Rights Movement back in the day, they got together, started singing, and praying, and training, right? Meetings and training and praying and singing. They got themselves together. What I say today is we got to shed our fear. Most of us don't do something because we're too afraid. We're scared. Oh my God, what if I mess up? What if they call me a racist? Well, they might. And what? So does that mean the injustice that needs to be dealt with? See. Did this system that we have now just create itself? I'll wait on that answer. Did it get built on its own? Who built it? Don't answer. You might incriminate your people. Who built it? So if we built it, can we not unbuild it and build another one over again? But we're too afraid because we might have to concede something. We might have to lose our space. We might have to live in a city next to a Negro. You might have to do it. And not just next to one, because that's okay. Or better yet, they might have to come out here to Newtown and live with you. Yeah, that got quiet in here then.
You can come to Newtown anytime.
Yeah, I know I can. But Pookie and Ray Ray may not want to come. Because there ain't nothing out here for Pookie and Ray Ray to hook up to, connect with. Ain't no other bloods out here. It's scary. No.
You don't want to get lost.
It's scary out here. I have, y'all don't really, this is for real. I don't do Camp Washington y'all just came back from. I don't do them things. I've been in the UCC, United Church of Christ, for 25 years. I don't go to the camps. You know why? Crickets. It's dark out there. And I have images of a cross being burning just over that hill. And the gathering of those guys with the hoods. Because, see, that's what happened where I live, in the dark, in the country. Can I get one other witness? Anybody know about them places? And so this, if the city is scary for you, out here is scary for me. I used to, in St. Louis, my dad and I used to go visit a friend of ours, and his dad, who was a physician and fairly well known in the particular town in St. Louis County, way down south. He wrote us a letter that we put in the glove box because every time we went to visit, we got pulled over. Pull over. Before the officer got up, we got into the glove box, got the letter out, showed the letter. Oh, okay. Have a nice night. We just had a report of vandals in the area. Story that you mentioned. I was leaving my church. Pamela had called and said, go buy Walgreens for something, you know. Go buy and get. And I went to go and I pulled to the right and saw all. It was actually CVS. I was going to stop at the CVS. CVS was closed. But the Walgreens cross street was open. So I got back in the left lane, turned the corner. Woo! He sees me. He doesn't, you know, generally when I pulled over, people noticed after a while, they noticed the collar. he didn't notice it. He said I was driving erratically. I said, sir, I'm going to the Walgreens. I was actually going to go to the CVS, noticed it was closed, and I just changed lane. Wasn't nobody in the street. Was I reckless? No, you weren't reckless. I just noticed you were swerving and I just put it to. That was that time. Pulled over again. the proverbial, there were vandals in the area, and you fit the description. So when I said that to the, it was the chief of police that was in that particular, of that time, Wethersfield, he was appalled. And what he said is, my officers never pull over anybody that, unless they've done something wrong. We'll go a long way if we just say, I'm sorry, we do the wrong thing every now and then. Can we, lastly, let me, I believe if we come alive, Cornel West in his book said, ain't nothing like being around somebody that catches fire when they come alive. I think we move toward action when we get lit up, when we've had enough. And so I ask you tonight, have you had enough? When is it enough that we risk maybe the friends that we have, that we come out for Black Lives Matter? I've never seen, when affirming me, how that somehow dishonors you. Women liberals back in the 70s. That didn't attack my manhood. Well, some men felt a little out of place, but it didn't attack my manhood to affirm your womanhood, to affirm my blackness. If, in fact, and I'm going to say this really clearly, if all matters, all lives really matter, my wife said it best, and it just messed me up, then act like it. We shouldn't have many systems that would reflect it. But when I look at every system we have in this country, race matters. Yeah. Every leading indicator, it matters. What are you talking about? And did we fixed it because we elected a black president, right? But that's what we do. We worked very hard, many of us, to. Wouldn't have ever dreamed that we would see in my lifetime a black president. Got one, and that was going to fix it. But we forgot to elect Congress that would work with him. And that was provided he was going to take on black issues. And he's not done much of that. And I said it. You can check me on that. Many in the African American community, like, he wasn't president, my president, you know. What did he do for me? Who was our friend? Turned out to be Richard Nixon. In the African American community, politically speaking, affirmative action got signed because of Richard Nixon. Many of the great society ideals of LBJ got turned into some decent legislation and law because of Richard Nixon. The worst gun law, prison reform set in motion by Bill Clinton. Oh, I forgot he was the first black president. Keep going, sir. I'm gonna end this and then we can talk to you and I want to talk to you now. I hope you still love me. You can keep going. William James Jennings down at Duke suggested that there are four components that got lost somehow or another in the religion of racism. And I want to suggest to you very strongly that racism is a kind of religion. That's why it keeps morphing and changing and why we can't seem to quite fix it, because it has it. We get evangelicalized, we get evangelized somehow or another. He said that we forgot that we're all Gentiles, scripture says. And we are all, he called it margined in some way. And when we forget gradually our marginalness, when we forget that we too are strangers and that we too
or on the outside of some stuff, when we forget that, we create the principality of whiteness. To which many of you, if I were to ask the question, what does it mean to be white? Would you know how to answer that honestly? Right? Because you don't really ever have to think about it. But I for doggone sure got to think about it because I'm a black man in America, where I am always, how I act always. And for God's sake, don't be mad. Don't be that angry Negro. Be affable, smile. Scratch when it don't itch to make sure that white people feel comfortable. I can tell you, August 9th, 2014, something broke. I ain't too likely to do that these days. I ain't gonna laugh when it ain't funny. Too serious. My children are taking bullets over and over again for no reason. Or better yet, because in Darren Wilson's words, Michael Brown looked like a demon. And can you explain to me what a demon looks like? When you're in a car with Kevlar on, with guns and tasers and such, what are you scared of? From a boy running, mouthing off, acting like he's 18. I don't know. Jenny suggested that we have a loss of space. And it's at that point, we have emerged with this idea of race, difference. We lose where we are. Space for him is the land we're on. So we came here to this land and we claimed it for France or England or for Belgium or Germany, right? Right? There were people here. What did we do with those people? Then we brought another group of people in here claiming they were free labor. But I would suggest to you, we already had a disdain. We had already declared this was manifest destiny. We were a light on a hill. There was a religion built around what we believed we were. We, meaning Puritans, who landed on Plymouth Rock. And they had an evangelical fervor that said they were claiming this land not only for their country, king and country, but for God. And you can't blame that all on Congregationalists, please. There were some Church of England folk abounding in that too. And he says, it is at that point we bought into the myth of imperialism. That we were the best. That we are the best. Colonialism then struck its chord all over the world. Keep going. I'm here. Go ahead, don't. Keep going. This woman right here, Bree Newsom, she's the young woman that went up on the flagpole. And I had occasion to be with her just recently and got a chance to spend some private time with her. And I finally got to myself and I said, girl, what did you think you would be? Because in Ferguson, we were together in Ferguson and she was the rock star. I was with Cornel West and all the other celebrities you know that were down there during the 1 year anniversary panel over there. And she got the most applause, the most sustained notice. Walking with her was dramatical. Because people wanted to pull on her, touch her, shake her hand. And I finally got a chance to, in the weekend, to talk to her. And I said, girl, did you know you were gonna be this kind of a rock star? You bigger than Cornel West, girl. And she laughed a little bit. She said, I thought about it for a few minutes, but she said, Bishop, let me tell you what I had to deal with. I had to be okay with the fact that I could go up that flagpole and not come down alive. She said, once I figured that out, it was all good. She's a hero of mine. Because what she did at that point
is that as she climbed, it was the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. I'll be right down, sir. I'll be right back. I promise. I'm coming back to you. She's talking to the police who had already. Says, if you've seen the videotape, watch the YouTube. Go to YouTube, too, because you will hear her mumbling. She's quoting scripture as she repels. So, and as she when she got the flag, she said, I'm coming right down. I'm coming right down to you. She then is our Father who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. It was an act of faith. Keep going. My brother Sekou said it like this. He said, if Black Lives Matter is a word, then Ferguson is that word made flesh. Mm-hmm. Keep going. I had the occasion to be with these powerful men. That's James Forbes, the pastor emeritus of Riverside Church. You know Cornell West. And that's Reverend Sekou. We had a boy moment. I don't know, Pamela was there. I just don't know what happened.
Yeah.
There was a boy, there was a guy moment. And what you miss in this picture, and that's why I use it, Dr. Forbes came up to greet all of us. We know each other. And he said, Bill Barber had just spoken and had lit the place on fire. It was electrifying. And he said, Dr. Forbes said, man, I remember what this felt like. This feels like the real thing. I think you're in this room because you sense something. Something is reminiscent of what we had in the 60s. Something's happening. There is a moment, there's a wave that's pushing. Can I inspire you to get mad at me enough? Or frustrated and aggravated enough at what ain't happened? What ain't good enough anymore? And I know I'm splitting some birds, ain't. What ain't good enough is not to do anything.
That's right.
That's just not acceptable any longer. We got to figure out what to do. I can't answer all of your questions about what to do, what should we do, what we ought to do. I have some suggestions, but we got to figure that out because it's now time to ride the wave. Mm-hmm. Montgomery to 64 and 65 was 10 years. We got about half that time before this wave is gone, in my opinion.